This is going to be another exciting session because we have some very special people in the house. And I see one of them is here. And I'm happy to see him in particular because we'd have had to shift things around waiting his arrival. Anyway, you'll hear more about who that person is. So let me welcome you to the 8th session of our Silver Anniversary Conference. The Most Honorable Hugh Lawson Shearer, for whom this lecture is named, was Prime Minister of Jamaica between 1967 and 1970. Sir, Mr. Shearer lived with diabetes for some 50 years, and his wife, the Most Honorable Professor Denise Eldemire Shearer, played a pivotal role in his care. Regrettably, she's unable to be here today. It is my distinct pleasure to introduce the presenter of the Most Honorable Hugh Lawson Shearer Memorial Lecture. She is Mrs. Shemala Mitchell Pullen. Now, I'll tell you a little bit about Shemala, who most of you would know from television. I'm sure you enjoy her programs. Shemala Mitchell Pullen is a broadcast journalist with the RGR Gleaner Group. She has served some 11 years producing and presenting television programs at Television Jamaica, TVJ. Known for her versatility, she also reports on health issues and other areas of national importance. Shemala is producer-presenter of The Health Report, a television program which seeks to educate viewers on health issues. She produces and presents A Ray of Hope, which highlights human interest stories. She's also a member of the team that produces the program All Angles on TVJ and Beyond the Headlines on RGR Radio. These are programs hosted by Dion Jackson Miller. Shemala Mitchell Pullen's interest in non-communicable diseases has allowed her to attend and cover the International Diabetes Federation, IDF, conference held in Brazil in 2009. So she has a distinct interest and information on diabetes. So she has extreme relevance to this conference. Shemala is also the winner of a number of prestigious awards, namely the Medical Association of Jamaica, MAJ Special Award, for long, dedicated, and outstanding reporting on health in the service of the society at large, and the TVJ News Center Staff of the Quarter Award on three occasions between 2016 and 2017. A goal-oriented person, ever striving for excellence, Shemala Mitchell Pullen is currently pursuing a Master of Sciences degree in Health Administration at the University of Technology, Jamaica. She has a Bachelor of Arts Communication Studies with emphasis on public relations from the Northern Caribbean University. Our 2019 presenter receives the Most Honorable Hugh Lawson Shearer Memorial Award for outstanding media support in promoting awareness of non-communicable diseases. And today, she will speak to us about the media in healthcare alertness. Please help me welcome Shemala Pullen.
Good morning, everyone. It is an honor and privilege for me to be here this morning to accept an award that is named after one of the former prime ministers of Jamaica, the Most Honorable Hugh Lawson Shearer, to the University Diabetes Outreach Program, UDOP. I say thank you for recognizing the work that I've done over the years, reporting on health-related issues. I must also say thanks to Television Jamaica and the RGR Gleaner Group CEO, Mr. Gary Allen. He understands my journey. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to explore and find my niche in health journalism. I am grateful and humbled by this experience. And to my husband, thank you for supporting and facilitating me. Thank you all once again. The media in healthcare alertness. Over the years, the media has played a critical role in the lives of many people. It is evident right around the world that persons spend a lot of time watching the television, reading the newspaper, surfing news sites on the World Wide Web, as well as listening to the radio. This media is always ready and available to provide news, especially on health-related issues. In Jamaica, we have over 20 media outlets. To name a few, we have under the RGR Gleaner Group, comprised of Television Jamaica, The Gleaner, Power 106, RGR Radio, and Hits 92. Others that don't fall under the RGR Gleaner Group would include CVM Television, The Jamaica Observer, and National and Nationwide News Network, among others. But what role has the media been playing in healthcare alertness? Well, our healthcare system in Jamaica affects each and every one of us, including those persons who have to produce and report the news daily. If you speak to a journalist, almost everyone can share a personal story with you about a close friend or a relative who had suffered from some kind of ailment that is linked to non-communicable disease such as cancer, hypertension, diabetes, stroke, heart disease, and the list goes on. I have had my own personal experience losing both parents to non-communicable diseases. My mom to pancreatic cancer in 2014. And my dad in 2018 to COPD. What my parents went through became a driving force for me to take an even more keen interest in health, developing within me an even deeper passion. I am always curious to know. I am always anxious to share what I've learned and to see how much of a difference I can make in someone else's life, which is why most of the news features I've done are centered around health-related issues. It is also the reason, with the encouragement of Professor Errol Morrison, that I am now almost at the end of completion of a master's in health administration. But other than the personal impact that healthcare issues have had, on us as media practitioners, the media plays a major role in informing and educating the public, especially about lifestyle diseases that can be prevented. I can proudly state that Television Jamaica has been doing its part, especially with its weekly health report program, which I have been producing and presenting for almost 10 years. TVJ's health report seeks to highlight health-related issues, signs and symptoms of health conditions, how those conditions can be prevented, and what can be done in case some of us slip through the cracks. Here are two examples of features that we have done so far. The first clip that you're about to see basically says, despite efforts by the government and other groups to control diabetes, it is still on the rise. Chairman of the Diabetes Association of Jamaica, Professor Errol Morrison, says, this is worrying as the cause for the increase is not known.
Health Report is brought to you by
people don't understand how serious it is.
Kian Morgan is among the more than 300,000 Jamaicans who are currently living with diabetes. Miss Morgan found out about her condition 8 years ago.
I had the usual symptoms, always wanting to pee, always tired, itchy, had a yeast infection that would not go away. I lost 10 pounds in 2 weeks without even trying. As I drink the water, I pass it out.
That's when she decided to see a doctor who later made the diagnosis.
She tested the sugar. It was 29. Normally your sugar should be, your glucose level should be between 4 and 5, and mine was 29. So you know it was very high.
Diabetes is a disease that occurs when your blood glucose, also called blood sugar, is too high. Obesity will increase your chances of getting the disease. Genetics also plays a role, which means if you have a history of diabetes in your family, you have a higher risk of developing the disease. But Ms. Morgan is not sure what contributed to her developing the disease. However, she had to make lifetime adjustments.
I'm on insulin and I have to inject myself every day. I'm on the type of medication that is fast acting and it's a mealtime insulin, which means that every meal I have to inject myself.
Professor Errol Morrison is an endocrinologist who specializes in diabetes. He is also the chairman of the Diabetes Association of Jamaica. Professor Morrison says despite efforts to treat and prevent the condition, it is still on the rise and he's not sure why.
If you use a round figure of the Jamaican population of about 2.7 million to 3 million, then you're looking at anywhere between 10 and 12%. And that is fairly high in terms of the world situation.
Professor Morrison says there needs to be greater awareness of the condition as many persons still do not take it seriously.
Stitching time can save so much of a limb from amputation, right? A stroke from setting in, heart attacks and so on.
He's also reminding persons that the doors of the Diabetes Association of Jamaica are always open for persons to do checks and get more information. Today is being celebrated as World Diabetes Day under the theme, Impact of Diabetes on the Family. With your health report, I'm Shemala Pullen wishing you good health.
Health report is brought to you by
The second clip says third world countries like Jamaica have high incidences of loss of limbs as a result of diabetes. This is why local experts are warning Jamaicans to take special care of their feet to avoid an infection that could result in amputation.
The Health Report is brought to you by
This woman was recently seen doing a routine foot check at the Diabetes Association of Jamaica. She is one of the approximately 300,000 Jamaicans who are currently living with diabetes. Head of the association, Professor Errol Morrison, says it is important to check the feet because after 10 to 15 years of living with the condition, at least 5% of those diagnosed would end up with an amputation. Professor Morrison tells the story of a man whose leg was surgically removed.
One morning he told us he smelled something in the bedroom, which he thought might have been a dead lizard or a dead rat or something. So he asked his wife to help him look for what might be causing this foul smelling room. And he couldn't find anything. And then just by chance, the wife was passing near the foot of the bed and said, "But Randy, the smell is coming from down here at the foot of the bed." And lo and behold, when they pulled back the sheets and really took us a good second look and smell, the man's foot was rotting.
Professor Morrison says this is because after a while, the diabetic would lose sensation in the affected area. He says this is due to nerve damage resulting in poor blood circulation.
The skin was drying and crackling and thinning, and now the tissue dying, it started to smell, gangrenous smell, dead flesh. And as a result, by the time we were seeing him, they had to find out at what level the blood flow was good. And they had to cut off his leg just below the knee where the flow was good.
Somebody may walk on a nail, may have an injury, a trivial injury, and they don't know like Masran, because they don't feel it, because the nerves are affected. The infection spreads very quickly.
Diabetics are being encouraged to take special care of their feet.
Whenever you go to the doctor, take off his shoes and socks and insist that the doctor, you know, inspects that foot carefully, right? Ensuring the proper, you know, care, the nails cut properly, any calluses or blisters attended to early, because it's prevention.
Diabetics should manage their blood sugar by eating a healthy diet consisting of fruits and vegetables. With your health report, I'm Shemala Pullen wishing you good health.
The media does not only inform, but it also keeps doctors and the government on their toes. For instance, the ongoing debate about the sugar reduction initiative in schools. It's an initiative the government continues to defend. Health Minister Dr. Christopher Tufton says he's disappointed with the comments made by Professor Errol Morrison about removing sugary products from schools. But opposition spokesman on health, Dr. Dayton Campbell, says the government needs to be clearer in its guidelines on the policy.
The government started its campaign limiting sugar products in schools, as at least 70% of the health ministry's annual budget is used treating non-communicable diseases. However, on Wednesday, chairman of the Diabetes Association of Jamaica, Professor Errol Morrison, raised concerns about the government's initiative, saying it's the wrong move. This has not gone down well with Health Minister Dr. Christopher Tufton.
It would be most discouraging if someone with that stature would make that statement against a body of work that is tested and proven, because it certainly wouldn't do a lot to help the cause of health and wellness in the country, which is what we're attempting to champion.
Dr. Tufton says not only does he find the comments from Professor Morrison to be very disappointing, but they're also of concern to some experts.
I mean, the International Federation on Diabetes, which is a global body, speaks about the challenge, the ill effects of sugar and excessive consumption of sugar and the links with obesity. The World Health Organization does the same. PAHO does the same. A number of studies. So, again, based on the interpretation of what was carried as opposed to what may have been the context, on the face of it, it certainly suggests that that statement flies in the face of significant research.
Meanwhile, opposition spokesman on health, Dr. Dayton Campbell, says Dr. Tufton needs to be clear in what he's trying to achieve.
It's something that has done this government, is that there's a lot of knee-jerk reaction. So you hear people say they get up and they're going to ban this, they're going to ban that. There's a lot of knee-jerk reaction. You need to have a study to explain to you and so you can further pass on that information to the parents so they can understand. Because even if you ban the sugary content in the schools and when the children go home, they're drinking a lot of sugar and water.
Shemala Pullen, TVJ News.
Former head of the Medical Association of Jamaica, MAJ, has weighed in on the impasse between the Ministry of Health and the head of the Diabetes Association, Professor Morrison, on the issue of sugar reduction in schools. Professor Winston Davison says neither the Ministry of Health or Professor Morrison is wrong. However, Professor Davidson cautions the health ministry that it needs to use this opportunity to be clearer in its messages.
Wrong or right? Former president of the Medical Association of Jamaica, Professor Winston Davidson, says both the Ministry of Health and head of the Diabetes Association of Jamaica, Professor Errol Morrison, are not wrong in their approach or views on the sugar reduction initiative in schools. According to Professor Davidson, there is a scientific basis for each position.
If you look at the statement in one particular context, it is true. When you look at it in another context, it is also true. But the conditions are different. And so therefore, it may not be true when put in a different context. You have to analyze the truth, scientific truth, not only as to how it manifests itself in your situation.
Professor Davidson says Professor Morrison was describing a specific situation while the health ministry is looking at the general picture.
If you say no sugary drinks, right, and you know, for example, that bag juice is a sugary drink. Yes, no sugary drink in general, because sugary drinks lead to the consequences, it to the outcome of obesity, etc. If you consistently do part of sugary drinks as part of your diet, but in a situation where you have a child who is hungry, goes to school hungry, what does the hunger mean? It means that her blood sugar level is low. And if the blood sugar level is low in the brain, she would not learn. So she passed the bag juice, man. It is cheap. It's best that she, better that she take the sugary drink and become more alert. Her brain have some glucose in there so that it can function.
However, he says while the health ministry has good intentions, it must be careful in how the messages it is sending are crafted.
The Ministry of Health continue to do what they're doing, but just be mindful of conditions which are nuanced. And therefore, we may have to see to what extent we should have the messaging take into account some other conditions that it may have missed.
He's now calling on both the Ministry of Health and Professor Morrison to sit down and discuss the concerns in order not to confuse the public. Shemala Pullen, TVJ News.
And these are some of the issues that we have to be discussing in media and healthcare. Sometimes the issues can become quite controversial, but even so, it still requires frank and open discussions. There's a new trend with nurse practitioners demanding prescriptive rights. However, some groups, including the Medical Association of Jamaica, are against it, while the health ministry is pushing for it. But should nurse practitioners be given this right?
It's been a bumpy ride. 62 nurse practitioners in Jamaica, and they all want full prescriptive rights. Already, countries like St. Lucia, the United Kingdom, Sweden, Spain, Australia, and some states in America have given nurse practitioners that privilege. But as it stands now in Jamaica, nurse practitioners are only allowed to write a prescription under the supervision of a medical doctor. This is based on a program the government started in the 1970s for nurse practitioners when there was a shortage of doctors. However, according to President of the Nurses Association of Jamaica, the current arrangement is different from what the original policy intended.
Many occasions, what you do have is that the nurses are given prescriptions that are already pre-signed to take with them when they go into the health centers. And so they, having assessed the patients, having interviewed the patients, will now write on that prescription that was pre-signed the treatment that they think is best suited to treat that patient's condition.
The Medical Association of Jamaica thinks it's a possible breach, as doctors must see what is written first on the prescriptions before they sign off on them.
The doctor bears the ultimate responsibility medically, legally, for what is written on the prescription and any effects that it might have on the patient.
Which is why Health Minister Dr. Christopher Tufton says the government is in the process of making changes to the Nurses and Midwives Act.
What we're seeking to do now with the amendment to the law is to give them greater authority in terms of signing, writing and signing.
But the MAJ is not convinced that's a safe path to go on.
We continue to have concerns about the policy because, to be honest, there are more questions that are raised rather than answers that are given.
Opposition spokesman on health, who is also a former president of the Junior Doctors Association, Dr. Dayton Campbell, says more information is needed on the changes.
Is it that they're going to undergo further training so they can understand how to make a full diagnosis and to prescribe the appropriate medication? So it is not something that can be done in a willy-nilly fashion.
But the Nurse Practitioners Association makes an argument based on the needs of patients in rural Jamaica.
You'll have a nurse practitioner who is assigned alone at a health center, or if she even alone assigned to a health center and the medical doctor cannot make it on that day and there's no replacement for that medical doctor, what will happen? The client will have to be seen and they will have to return the following day for the prescription. No, that can be a grave challenge to the clients.
But the question now is, how qualified are these nurse practitioners to have this level of independence? That will be discussed tomorrow in the final of our three-part series looking at prescriptive rights. Shemala Mitchell, TVJ News.
Health Minister Dr. Christopher Tufton, in the follow-up to that story, announced that changes are coming to the Nurses and Midwives Act that gives nurse practitioners full prescriptive rights. Over the years, nurse practitioners have been complaining about the challenges they face writing prescriptions and having to wait for a doctor to co-sign. But the doctors think giving these nurse practitioners that level of independence can be risky for patients.
Treating the common flu to an ear infection or just some of the common ailments nurse practitioners would be limited to writing prescriptions for. Health Minister Dr. Christopher Tufton says based on what is proposed in the amendments of the law, there is no doubt these nurse practitioners are capable of carrying out this task. And so Dr. Tufton says the changes will happen before you know it.
Having had the approval, where we are now is to get the code signed off on, which I think we're there, and then of course the amendments to the law, the Nursing and Midwifery Act.
Head of the School of Public Health at University of Technology, Professor Winston Davidson, has trained many of these nurses. Professor Davidson was also one of the persons who helped to make changes to the Act in the 1970s that allowed nurse practitioners the right to write prescriptions under the supervision of a medical doctor. But the professor does not think these nurses are qualified to be given this level of independence.
They do not have the proper training for making diagnosis.
No, they don't need any further training. They have been practicing for years, and we have not had any questionable circumstances under which these nurses have been prescribing or been treating their patients. They are taught how to write prescription. From being a general trained nurse, you are taught how to do your physical assessment, anatomy and physiology, pathophysiology.
Again, Professor Davidson thinks more training is needed despite what Ms. Johnson outlined.
A nurse would have to have pharmacology and therapeutics, pathology, we'll just go through some basic anatomy too.
The Pharmaceutical Association of Jamaica says it's not against nurse practitioners getting that right, but it's not convinced that they're adequately trained to perform this function.
We sometimes have to make inquiries because sometimes the drugs are duplicated, and so sometimes we have to call back to ensure that that is what is really required.
Meanwhile, the Medical Association of Jamaica argues that they have about 4,000 doctors currently working in the island. It also said close to 300 more are trained each year. Therefore, they have more than enough to put in health centers. But it claims the ministry is not promoting some of these doctors for this to happen. It thinks the move by the government is a strategy.
They would prefer to have a nurse practitioner deployed to many of the private health centers because it's cheaper for them.
It would be unfortunate. I don't know how you would get that through Parliament.
The changes are expected to be made this legislative year. Shemala Mitchell, TVJ News.
Mass media has come a far way in reporting on issues affecting people's health. Let us take another example with the deadly HIV/AIDS, when there was a lot of stigma about the disease. This was until people were able to better understand and have a behavioral change towards persons infected with the virus. When the Zika virus was identified in Jamaica in 2016 amidst great global concern, the local media was instrumental in raising public awareness, working with agents in the health sector. The virus was able to be controlled. The most recent instance was in December 2018 when the country experienced the dengue outbreak. The media was constantly informing the public, attending press conferences called by the Ministry of Health, going into homes with health teams to see what were some of the reasons why certain areas had more cases than others, and just basically running with whatever information it could about what to do and what not to do. So by March 2019, the Ministry of Health was in a position to report that it was seeing less cases of the virus coming into the public health system. But despite the media having a responsibility to report accurate health and science information to the public, there are setbacks. These setbacks sometimes are triggered by a lack of cooperation from policymakers in the healthcare system. Sometimes when journalists request information, problems arise because these policymakers are not always ready and willing to share for numerous reasons. Sometimes it is politically motivated, trying to protect the government or prevent bad publicity for the healthcare system. There seems to always be a stigma where once the media is involved, it is bad, and that the media never had anything good to say. As a media practitioner, I admit that there is still room for growth. There are times when we don't always get it right because of our failure to fully understand an area before filing a report. But despite our shortcomings, we have managed to help bridge a gap between doctors and how they communicate with the public at large, especially with their medical jargon, which the man on the street may struggle to understand. At times, I show up at public health facilities, and when speaking to persons, they will tell you that they're frustrated because they can't understand what the doctors are saying. And most times, this is where the media would come in, seeking clarity on health issues for persons to have a better understanding. In closing, I firmly believe that if the media and those in healthcare can establish common ground to address the challenges, then I think the media can play a far greater role in informing the public about potentially life-threatening issues pertaining to our health.
Thank you so much, Shemala, for that very enlightening, entertaining, refreshing, picturesque narrative of what happens in the relationship between media, public, and policymakers. And this is very real. I did a course, a master's in communication for social and behavior change some years ago. And these are some of the issues that we had to go through, you know, sift through to see why and to find answers. This has been a very, very important lecture. And I wonder how well we are doing with time, if we allow for a few questions, maybe about two questions. Anybody has any burning question? We'd ask Shemala to answer. You shouldn't have gone down, Shemala. But everything has been so patent and clear. We all agree with what we have heard. Yeah, is that what you're saying? Okay. So on your behalf, we just thank Shemala for coming. And I see she brought coverage. She has her husband with her. And she brought even our own CEO, Mr. Gary Allen. And she also has extra company, which you can see for yourself. So a big round of applause for the team.